Hey everybody, and welcome to church. We are so excited that you joined us today. And if you're new here, we want to extend a really special welcome to you, and we want to meet you. So stop by the Info Center right after this message so we can say hi to you and to your family. We got a lot of stuff happening in the life of our church. We're going to tell you all about it today. But one thing we want to make sure everyone knows about is our groups. These are so important to how we do church at First Burleson. This is where we find our friends. It's where we gain accountability and enter into discipleship. And so if you're ready to take your next step and join a group, scan this QR code to find out more.
Good morning, church family. My name is Christine, and I'm here to tell you all about our kids' ministry. If you have a preschooler, that means that they're from birth to kindergarten. We would love to have them during our preschool life groups at 9 or 10:30. If you have a child from first grade up into our preteen area, their life groups meet at 10:30. So if you have a kiddo who's looking to get plugged in, we would love to meet them.
Hey there, our students are meeting on Sunday mornings at 10:30 in the merge room for student Sundays. And we have a lot of events going on, just little things from week to week that we'd love for your teenagers to be a part of. You can find more information about our student ministry, as well as more information on all the events we have by scanning the QR code.
Amen. Well, good morning, Burleson family. It's great to see you all here this morning. For those tuning in online, welcome. We're excited to have you here this morning. As we begin our worship, I want to draw our attention to the word of the Lord in Psalm 96. It says this, "Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the people. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods." Let's all stand together as we sing to our Lord. Come, Christians, join to sing. Let's lift our voices in praise.
Come, Christians, join to sing.
Our soul.
truth can cause a troubled soul. God is good, God is good. Where is his grace and goodness known? In our great Redeemer's blood, who holds our faith when fears arise, who stands above the stormy trial, who sends the waves that bring us nigh unto the
wonderful singing this morning, wonderful truth in those songs. At this time, let's turn to one another, share the joy of the Lord with each other this morning.
Good morning, good morning, First Baptist Burleson. Man, it is good to be back with you guys today. My name's Justin. I'm one of our pastors and residents here, and I'm excited to tell you about all the things that the Lord is doing here at First Baptist. First thing I want to tell you about, though, is that we are all about two things here. We are about pursuing Christ and loving people, and that's in everything that we do. Now, all the things that we do, there's a lot going on. It can be difficult to keep up with it all. And so we put everything in one convenient place just for you. So I want to encourage you to pull your phone out, open up your camera, and scan this QR code that's going to be up on the screen. It'll take you to a link tree where you'll find all sorts of helpful information on there just for you. Like if you're new with us, there's a Connect card. Fill that out so we can get to know you better and see how we can serve you better. There's also a giving link if you'd prefer to give your gift online to help us make impacts in the kingdom both locally and globally. And then you'll also find information about all the things that we have going on and coming up here at First Baptist. There's several things I want to tell you about today. First thing is next Sunday, August 21st, is our Vision Sunday. This is a Sunday you don't want to miss. Pastor Ronnie is going to cast his vision. He's going to tell us about where we're heading in this fall season, and so you don't want to miss that. So be here in person or online and worship with us that day. Second, the following Wednesday, August 24th, is our volunteer kickoff.
This is for everybody in our church. If we can't do the things that we do here without your help, without volunteers. And so we want to celebrate with you. We want to fellowship with you and also show you where we're going this fall in our ministries. And if you haven't had the opportunity to join a ministry yet, this is a perfect opportunity to come join in a meeting and see what is going on in that ministry and see if it's a perfect fit for you. Third is August 31st. Is our kickoff for our fall, our Wednesday nights, and we're starting off with a class that's going to help us as a church raise the next generation. So we're calling this class Next. You can scan the QR code to find out more about it, but this is for everybody in our church. It doesn't matter if you have kids, if you're a grandparent, if you don't have kids, it's for you, and we want you to come with us and join with us as we raise the next generation. Finally, I want to tell you about two town halls. The first one is today at 5 o'clock. It's going to be in our fellowship hall, and we're going to be discussing the budget. And then on Wednesday, this Wednesday, August 17th at 6:30, is our next town hall, also in the fellowship hall, to discuss the bylaws. So that's all I've got for you today. We're going to continue in worship and hear from Pastor Ronnie, but before we do that, will you pray with me? God, thank you so much for all that you're doing here at First Burleson. Thank you for allowing us to be a part of it. God, I ask that you make us attentive to your word today, that you cover Pastor Ronnie and your grace and your blessing, and that you speak through him this morning. Thank you again for all that you do for us, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. We need our Lord every hour of every day. Let's continue now our time of worship by singing Grace Greater Than Our Sin.
Thank you. Good morning, y'all. Good morning. What's he going to say now? Yeah. Man, what a good group. It's good to see people back from summer trips, vacations. School must have started. Yes. All the parents said amen. Yeah, it's good. Good to see you back. Couple of things just want to reiterate. You've heard the announcements already this morning, but tonight at 5 o'clock, in the fellowship hall, we have a town hall meeting just to discuss the budget. 5 o'clock tonight, fellowship hall, down that way, we'll meet. And it's just to talk about the budget. This Wednesday at 6:30, no matter what you've read, 6:30 in the fellowship hall. If we need to talk more about budget, we can, but our focus for that meeting is the bylaw revision that we're going through. We've taken the summer to think and pray and question about the changes that we're going through the bylaws, and so we'll have that final discussion time this Wednesday at 6:30 in the fellowship hall. And then we'll vote on both on the 28th, Sunday the 28th, and so you'll be excited to look forward to that, or not. Also, today we start our deacon nominations. There are ballots available in our information centers, also on our app under news and events. You can go and there's some application forms, background checks, blood tests, things like that. Not really, it's just this, all right? And you can nominate, there's a list of, I don't know that this was the right title to put. Inside the insert, it says eligible men. That's not, that's not what you're thinking. I've had a few concerned wives come up and ask me questions about that. That means eligible to serve for deacons, so let's make sure we're clear on that, okay? If you misunderstood that, we need to talk, okay? Well, so every Sunday we have a This Is Us statement, right? We are learning what it means to be the body of Christ. We're learning what it means to be me familia, my family, to be a family together. And it fits right into what we're talking about through this sermon series. And so this morning I just want us to say out loud again in a form of commitment, a verbal commitment, that we are people who build each other up. Can we just say we build each other up? We build each other up. Right? That is our goal and our focus. We don't tear one another down. There's too much of that in the world. Church needs to be a place where we are all encouraged. We are all lifted up. Sometimes with difficult words, sometimes with tough love, but it should be a place where we can come and be encouraged. After being beat up by the world or whatever's been happening, that we can come and encourage to build one another up. You remember the saying, your parents probably taught you this, if you can't say something nice about someone, don't say anything at all. I think we need to revisit that, especially when it comes to social media. Can I get an amen? People get very bold on social media. And if you're about to post something negative, just stop. Don't do it. We don't need your opinion on that. We don't need to hear what you don't like. Let's be encouraged. What a great platform to be encouraging. So let's do it that way. Let's be encouraging. Even when we post, even when we talk, even when we think, we don't gossip about one another. We don't tear each other down. We don't poke fun at one another. We build each other up. That's what God's called us to do. And I don't know about you, but I need encouragement. I need to be with my family. I need to know somebody loves me, somebody cares about me, and someone's for me. I've got people in my corner, right? We all need that. So let's be that kind of people, all right? We build each other up. So we're in this series called Unveiled. And again, that's the... Hopefully a picture has been painted for you of what that means and kind of reflection on art. If you're unveiling art, a statue, if you're unveiling the new car at the car show. I was also reminded, I know when Robin and I got married, Robin had a veil on. I don't know that that's done much anymore, right? But she wore a veil. Many of you wore veils in your weddings. And taking that veil over off the face, which I blew in my wedding. I got to be honest. I wasn't prepared. I had no veil training going into this thing. And so it came time for the kiss, which I was looking forward to. And so I got to take the veil and take it off of Robin's face to totally unveil her beauty, right? But I stopped short. I put it on top of her head which apparently was the wrong thing to do. So I'm leaning in for the kiss, the big moment I hear, put it all the way over. That's when I discovered Robin was a ventriloquist, because without moving her lips, I just heard, all the way over, all the way over. Oh, okay, so I had to back up and redo it, right? Yeah. So that's what we're looking at through this series. We want total unveiling, right? We want the glory of Christ shining through us. We are being unveiled as people. Sin has been a veil for us. But through Jesus Christ, that veil has been removed. And so it's a process. As you've seen unveiling at ceremonies, it's a process. That veil is slowly removed off to reveal the beauty that is behind it. That's the idea that we see in Scripture, what it means to be transformed in Christ, to be in the image of Christ. We are being unveiled. We are becoming more and more like Christ every day. And so last sermon, I told you about the acrostic change, and that's to fit that sermon in this sermon. We're going through the acrostic change, looking at points of what it means to be transformed. So let me just remind you of the first part of that. C, in the word change, is centered on Jesus. Our life should be centered on Jesus. We talk about that all the time. It becomes a cliche for us many times, but what does that really mean to have my life, my marriage, my family, my career, my entertainment, everything is centered on Jesus. He truly is the center of my life, which means I need to know him more. I need to understand him more. I need to understand who I am in Christ as a representative of Christ, to be an imitator of Christ. What does that mean? To center my life on Christ. H in the word change is Holy Spirit led. If we're going to accomplish this goal of being transformed, it has to be done by the Holy Spirit. It's not something we can manufacture, because when we start to do that, we just start changing the outside, but never really changing the inside. And so and then the A of change is to avoid boundary markers. And I kind of explained that a little bit. Here's, again, the definition of a boundary marker. They are highly visible, relatively superficial practices, matters of vocabulary or dress or style, whose purpose is to distinguish between those inside a group and those who are outside of a group. And so if we are not being transformed the inside, our default is to just change the outside with never addressing the inside so that we look like we transformed, so that we look Christian or sound Christian. Again, most of us have been around church long enough to know how to do those things, but inside we could be dying. Inside we could be anxious. Inside we could be fearful. Inside, we could be struggling with doubts, but we don't want anyone to know it, so we polish the outside without addressing what's really going on inside of our heart, inside of our minds. And it's not just sin. It could just be confusion, right? It could be doubt. It could be fear and anxiety, but we don't want to address those because we don't want someone to think that we have problems. We don't want anyone to know that we're flawed, so we really work hard on the outside to polish it and make it look good. Inside, we're hurting. Church should be the one place that we can be open and honest about what's going on inside. Not that we do that with everyone. We're not going to stand on the stage and proclaim our issues and our struggles. But we need to have brothers and sisters that we can trust to come alongside us and allow us to be real with what's going on, what's hurting, where we're failing, without fear of judgment and condemnation. That's what God's calls, that's what it means to be a family in Christ. That I can be real before you, and I'm not afraid that you're going to condemn me for my sin because you're a sinner just like me. But in that, we actually find healing. We find hope that is in Christ because we are becoming more like him, loving like him, which means we love unconditionally, without pretense, not based on performance. We just love like Jesus loves us, which compelled us into a relationship with the Father. It was that he loved us first and pursued us. And when we realized that, it was a glorious moment. But that was the beginning of a journey of becoming more and more like Christ, being transformed, sanctified in the image of Christ. And so this morning, I want to continue the acrostic with the letter N, which stands for never stop growing. Again, transformation is a daily, ongoing process. It is not perfected in our salvation. In our conversion, we didn't perfectly do it right. We didn't all of a sudden start living perfect righteous lives. It is a process of understanding more and more about God and who we are. Here are several scriptures to back up that idea that we should never stop growing in Christ, never stop growing spiritually. One is Paul's writing in Philippians chapter 1, verses 3 through 6. This is what Paul writes. I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. Being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. So here we see God's plan for us is to transform us. His desire is that we become more like his son. We are image bearers. We are made in the likeness of God. So God's desire and design for us is to transform us. In process, but that's his goal. Never to allow us to remain where we are. There should always be a desire for growth. Which means we have to commit to this process. We have to commit to the disciplines of our faith. Commit to spiritually growing. One of my favorite movie series is Rocky. I mean, the original, there's none better, right? But you remember Rocky III? Where Rocky III, you know, Mickey, his trainer, has died, and Rocky's going through all this inner turmoil and all this chaos, and he's just not the boxer he used to be. And then Apollo Creed, remember Apollo Creed, his opponent in the first two movies, comes alongside. Now he's a friend of Rocky's. And so Rocky had been beaten by Clubber Lang, Mr. T, right? Just annihilated. He just stood there. He just took all these punches. He just wasn't the same guy. And so Apollo Creed comes up to Rocky and said, the problem is you've lost the eye of the tiger. And that's where we have a great song from Survivor, right? So you've lost the eye of the tiger. And if you saw that movie, which is a great movie, you didn't need to go watch it. Then Apollo gets him back to the basics of his training, the basics of his discipline. Not all the fancy stuff, not all the glitz and glamour, but just hardcore training. Sometimes that's what we have to realize. We are in times of hardcore training. We have to be committed to the disciplines, committed to the faith, committed to spiritually growing, which takes these commitments to the disciplines, prayer, Bible study. It's the basics, right? Sometimes it's just when we get in a time of chaos or confusion, just go back to what you know. When you're wondering, doubting what is God doing in my life, my future, go back to what you know about him. Look back at the times he's been faithful in your past. That same God that was faithful then will be faithful now. And that removes some of that anxiety and that stress that we're under, wondering, what is God up to? He is up to good. He is good. But circumstances cause us to doubt that oftentimes. But we have to be committed that we are going to grow. Paul says again in Philippians 2:13, for it is God who works in you to will and to act according to his good purpose. That verse tells us that God wants to do the work. God is the one who does the work in us. Again, it's not something we manufacture. Just in obedience and faith, we follow God. We trust and obey him. And he does the work. It's not something we can create. But humanly, we're driven that way, right? I've got to fix it. I have to do it. I have to make it happen. And we fail miserably. And it just puts us in that endless cycle, that anxious cycle of wondering, can I ever be more like Christ? Yes, because it's God who does the work, not us. But we can always put obstacles and barriers in front of him. And sometimes it's in our mind. Paul says we are transformed by the renewing of our mind. First of all, we have to believe we can be transformed, regardless. Because it's God's power working in us, not ours. And we don't always do it right. And we don't always listen and obey. And we don't always trust. But that does not hinder God's will and desire to transform us. We have to learn how to rely on him. Philippians 3:10 through 12, Paul says, I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow to attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I've already obtained all this, I've already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Here's the Apostle Paul, the rock star of Christianity, who says the same thing. Not that I do it right all the time, but I keep going. I don't stop. I don't deny the power of God in my life. Even when I don't do it right, even when I fail, even when I do the things I shouldn't do, I don't let that stop me from continuing to grow. to accepting and understanding what it means to live in the forgiveness of God. Do you know that forgiveness of God is available to you right now, regardless of what you've done? God's grace is sufficient for you to live the transformed life. That's what that passage is talking about. It is sufficient for you. Jesus' blood covered all of our sins. Our job is to learn how to live in that truth and not let the whispers of the enemy discourage us. That's one of his most powerful weapons, is discouragement. He can't have our soul, but he can really mess with our head. And he can discourage us and get us to focus on our circumstances and our ability rather than on God's. And that's a dangerous place to be. Luke 2:52, the Bible says that Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. We have the four sections of life here, and the Bible tells us that Jesus grew in those areas. When he was on the earth as a human being, he grew in those areas. So if Jesus saw the importance of growing in these areas, shouldn't we? He set the example for us to grow in all of these areas. Now, he was fully God, but he set the example for us to grow. But the danger is we have to beware of pseudo-growth, fake growth. Again, we can manufacture. We know how to wear the masks and the costumes to make it look like we're growing. We know how to say the words and convince everyone that everything's going great with us spiritually, that we're on fire for Jesus, we're on fire for the Lord, that we're pursuing Christ, when all the time we know inside that we're really not. We're pursuing the world, or we're pursuing our own desires rather than his. But man, when we come to church, we better shape up, we better act right. Because someone's going to find out that we're not who we say we are. That's a dangerous place to live. So if we're not being filled with greater and greater amounts of love and joy, it could be because we've accepted some kind of a fake growth, a pseudo growth. We're learning to look Christian rather than truly be Christian, to do all the things a Christian should do rather than truly be transformed in our lives. And so in that, we start to look for outside ways to convince people, pseudo experiences of growth that make us feel good about ourselves, things that distinguish us from others who are not Christians. But it's all just polishing the outside. The truth of the matter is, when God changes the inside, the outside changes as well. But that's what makes it last, when it comes from a true heart and a mind that's being transformed. Then those actions, behaviors, bring glory to God. It's not just about behavior modification. We could all do that. But now the actions are what God's will for us is. And they bring glory to his kingdom. It helps us. If we're not being transformed on the inside, we can settle for being informed or conformed. It's just about knowledge, right? Well, if I just know a lot of things and know how to say the right things, and knowledge puffs up, right? And that leads to pride and arrogance. Or we just conform. The Bible says, do not be conformed to this world. But sometimes we just kind of conform to Christianity rather than being truly transformed inside. We just fake it. Dallas Willard, famous author, said this: how many people are radically and permanently repelled from the way or from Christianity by Christians who are unfeeling, stiff, unapproachable, boringly lifeless, obsessive, and dissatisfied? Yet such Christians are everywhere, and what they are missing is the wholesome liveliness springing from a balanced vitality with the freedom of God's loving rule. Spirituality, wrongly understood or pursued, is a major source of human misery and rebellion against God. Do you really understand what spirituality is all about? Again, we have a tendency to want to compartmentalize that area of our life. I've got my spiritual life, I've got my physical life, I've got my emotional life. And God said, we are all spiritual. Body, mind, and spirit, God made us. Everything we do has a spiritual dimension. Everything we do is involved in spirituality. Even the way we eat, even the way we take care of ourselves, even the way we relate, it all has a spiritual dimension to it. So we should be growing, as Jesus did, in all areas of our life. Because it all impacts our spirituality and our spiritual growth. So how do we make sure that we're not settling for some kind of pseudo or fake transformation? Well, I want to share a series of questions that I think we need to ask ourselves on a regular basis. The first one is this: am I spiritually inauthentic? In other words, am I trying to be spiritual or just look spiritual or just sound spiritual? Do I work harder at making people think I'm loving than I work at actually loving people? Do I try to convince people I'm loving, or do I work hard at really loving people, loving like Jesus loves? We can become very inauthentic spiritually, inauthentic as Christians. It's like the story you've probably heard about the little boy in Sunday school. And we know, you know, we always joke about Sunday school answers: God, Jesus, the Bible. That's the only thing we ever answer in Sunday school. And so this little boy was in class with his Sunday school friends, and the teacher asked this question. He said, "What is brown, has a long tail, and harvests nuts for the winter?" And it was just dead silence in the classroom. Nobody could think about the answer. And one little boy says, "Well, I'm sure the answer is Jesus, but it sounds a lot like a squirrel." So we know the answer to give, right? We know the things to say that make us sound authentic when really we're not. So am I spiritually inauthentic? The second question: am I becoming judgmental or exclusive or proud? Matthew 23, Jesus said these words about the Pharisees: "Everything they do is done for men to see. They make their phylacteries wide and the tassels on their garments long. They love the place of honor at banquets and the most important seats in the synagogue." Why? Because their knowledge had puffed them up. They were full of pride and arrogance. They expected to be noticed when they did things for God. They wanted everyone to see. It's easy to fall in that trap, right? We want people to see these things that we're doing because we like the applause of man. We like for people to notice and recognize and applaud. So it causes us to question, am I authentic in what I'm doing? Am I really doing this to bring glory to God? Or am I really doing it to bring glory to me? We can fall into that in church work as well, in ministry as well. We want everyone to notice what we're doing for God. This displeases the Father. Am I becoming judgmental or exclusive or proud? The next question: am I becoming more approachable or less? You know, it's interesting, in Jesus' day, when he was here on the earth, the tax collectors, the prostitutes, those with leprosy, they avoided the rabbis because the rabbis were considered closer to God than anyone else, and so they didn't want to be around them. But when Jesus came, God in the flesh, who did he hang out with? The tax collectors, the prostitutes, the lepers. He was in their midst, because somehow they understood their need for God, and they were more open and approachable by God. And so that's who Jesus hung out with. That's our example. We're in the world. We're not of the world, but we're in the world, and we're in the world for a purpose. That the world, those outcasts, those who are hurting, might see that God is love. And there is a way for them to be rescued from the power of sin in their life. This is our responsibility. May we never be so haughty and arrogant and prideful that the world feels that we're unapproachable. Are we more approachable or less? And then the last question: am I growing weary of pursuing spiritual growth? Am I growing weary of pursuing spiritual growth? Guys, have you ever noticed that if you've gone shopping with your wife, right? Because you love her and you want to have nice things, and so you decide, I want to spend time with you, so you go shopping. Have you ever just stopped to notice how long those experiences seem? How it just seems to take forever to go shopping with your spouse. But if you're going shopping for you, it's a different story, isn't it? I mean, all of a sudden, you turn into super shopper, right? I'll go in, I get it, I'm out, I'm gone, right? I know what I want, I go find it, and there's joy in that. Why? What's the difference? Because when you're shopping for you, it's something meaningful for your life. I mean, you love your wife, and you want to be there, and you want to be happy and all that. But when it's for you, that's a whole different story. The same thing comes with spirituality. When we're understanding that spiritual pursuit has meaning for us, It is vital to us. It brings joy and happiness to us. It's a different perspective. Rather than just seeking things that look spiritual, we realize that the things of God are vital to us. To enjoy the fruit of the Spirit, to understand purpose and meaning in life. And then all of a sudden, it's not just a bunch of doing things. It's not just a bunch of actions. It truly is an experience that we seek, that we truly have a desire to pursue Christ. Again, it's not just doing the things Jesus would do. It's wanting to do the things Jesus would do. That's the difference. When we start to have that same desire, when God gives us the desires of our heart because they are His desires, that's when we start to understand the experience of being transformed, of sanctification. I'll share the quote I shared last week from Frank Laubach, who said this: if you are weary of some sleepy form of devotion, probably God is as weary of it as you are. God knows our motivation. He knows our heart. He knows our desire. So G in the word change is go slow. If we are focused on transformation, transformation will occur. Just don't rush the process. Trust the process. Trust that you are in a process of sanctification, that you're becoming more like Christ. But spend some mental time thinking about that. What does that look like for you? What is God seeking to do in your life? Be focused on it. Don't rush. You've heard people say, I don't want to get out ahead of God. Then don't. Be patient and wait. That's hard, right? When we want something, we want it now. It's my money and I want it now. It's my spirituality and I want it now. It's a process. God is working. Again, it's His will to work in us. Don't rush the process. Don't try to get out ahead of Him. Don't try to figure out what He's doing, where He's leading. Just trust Him. We'd love to have roadmaps, right? We'd love to have a spiritual GPS to show us where we're going and what it looks like. God never promised to give us that. But He promised never to abandon us. He promised to lead us. He promised to transform us, and we can trust in this. Remember the story of Abraham and Sarah? They got out a little ahead of God, right? Sarah had not had any children, and so she came up with this plan with Hagar that Abraham would go and sleep with Hagar, and they would hopefully have a son, and that would get things rolling. That would start the descendants. And so they did, and Ishmael was born. But he wasn't the child of promise. And eventually Isaac was born to Sarah in their old age. It was a miracle. It was amazing. But it was God's promise. But then they still had to deal with Hagar and Ishmael. Can I just tell you, your Isaac's coming. Just be patient and wait. Don't try to run out ahead. Don't try to make things happen. When it comes to our spirituality and our maturity and our growth, just trust God daily. Psalms 27:14 says, wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord. We're actually being strengthened as we wait for the Lord. We will mount up on wings like eagles. We will run and not grow weary. Just be patient. I know that's a hard word for us. Everybody struggles with patience. But it's important when it comes to spiritual growth. And then the E in change is expect others to change. In the family of God, there should be an expectation that all of us are being transformed. All of us are becoming more like Christ. That's the whole motivation behind the This Is Us series that we just went through a few months ago. This is us. This is who we are. There should be an expectation that we're going to live lives based on who we are in Christ. And as brothers and sisters in Christ, when we see one another not living this is us, not living according to our spiritual nature, it is our responsibility to say, hey, you're not acting like yourself. You're not acting like who you are. You're acting like who you used to be. Now stop it. Change. We should expect each other to change. Kind of a weird thought came to my mind as I was studying this part of this word, change. I grew up watching The Brady Bunch, right? You remember that show? Great family show, great sitcom that you could watch with the whole family back in the day. Remember that? So there was one episode that they all, you know, used to sing. So there was an episode, there was a song that they sang as a family that just kind of weirdly came back to my mind. And so I wanted to share this weirdness with you.
Now, when it's time to change.
be like, what in the world was that? Don't you miss those outfits? So, you know, here's one of the kids, they're changing, right? Puberty's happened, voice is changing. We expect that. We expect people to physically change. We expect that we go through experiences physically as human beings. We should have that same expectation when it comes to our spiritual life. We should expect one another to change, even spur one another on, even encourage one another in this issue of transformation. Again, you're not called to live your faith journey by yourself. You're not called to experience transformation by yourself. That's what it means to be a part of the family. We encourage one another. We teach one another. We're there for one another. We struggle with one another. We rejoice and we weep with one another. That's what it means to be a family. We're all in that state of transformation. So it's not as scary. It's not as frustrating when we realize I'm not the only one. First of all, you're not the only one who needs to change, but you're not the only one who is changing. We're all a part of this. John Ortberg, in his book, The Life You Always Wanted, tells of a man in his church named Hank. And this is how he describes Hank. Hank was the type of guy that could discover islands of bad news in a sea of happiness. He would always find a cloud where others would find a silver lining. A deacon in his church asked him one day, Hank, are you happy? Hank paused to reflect, and smiling, said, yeah. And the deacon said, well, tell your face. And he goes on to talk about Hank was just a constant complainer. And so one time he got on the issue that the music was too loud. And so he began to complain to the staff. He began to complain to the deacons, other deacons. He began to complain to anybody who would listen. He would even start complaining to guests who were there on Sunday about the music being too loud. In fact, at one point, Hank called OSHA to have them send out an investigator to investigate if the music was too loud. And so the staff and the investigator who actually came out from OSHA kind of had a laugh about it. But then the pastor made this statement. He said, the sad news was that no one expected Hank to ever change. He was a grumpy young man who grew into a grumpy old man. And no one expected that Hank would become more and more like Jesus. Do you really expect to change? Do you really expect others in the family of faith to become more like Jesus? We should. We need to have that expectation for ourselves, that even when we don't do it right, it's not going to stop our desire to be more like Jesus. But when we see another brother and sister in Christ who is struggling in an area that we see evidence they're not living like Jesus, it is our responsibility to lovingly, with much prayer, led by the Holy Spirit, to come alongside and say, hey, brother, you're not acting like who you are. Hey, we committed. We don't gossip about one another. We don't tear each other down. Hey, we don't cheat on our spouses. We need to get back to who we are. And we come alongside and we help, not in judgment and condemnation, but in love, realizing that it's the grace of God that changed us. It's the grace of God that changes others, and we get to play a part in that. So here's a challenge I have, that this week you will pick a quadrant of your life. Like Jesus changed. We read that Jesus changed in these areas, mind, body, spirit, relationships, that you'll pick a quadrant of your life that needs to change. And this week you'll take maybe a small step, but you'll take a step towards change in that area of your life. You'll sit down with God and just be honest with him. God, here's an area of my life where I'm struggling to be obedient. Here's a sin in my life that I've chosen to allow to remain. Here's an attitude that I have. Here's a grudge that I harbor against someone. Here's an attitude that I've adopted. I've become a complainer. I've become negative. Here's a relationship that needs to be mended. God, help me to take a step towards change in that area of my life. Maybe it's your relationship with God. Just some things need to change. Maybe it's how you feel about who you are in Christ. for some reason, you've done something that's caused you to stop desiring and stop growing in your walk with Jesus. Remember, it is God's desire to work in you, to bring out, to unveil the Spirit that lives within you. It takes intentionality on our part to let that happen. In just a minute, I'm going to pray. And here and in our modern service, we'll have a prayer team down front, and they're simply here to talk to you. Maybe you're here today and you don't have a relationship with Jesus, but you're ready to enter into one. They can help you walk through that process of what that looks like. Maybe you're here and you just need some prayer. And you don't have to give out details. You say, hey, there's an area of my life. I just need you to pray for me. And they will. Or if you need to talk to someone, whatever you need today, we're here to help. And as we've seen, you can come forward or you can come after the service. They'll be there as well. Or you can come to the connection point. I'll be there. Other pastors will be there. Or you can email us or text us. Whatever. Just realize you don't have to do this alone. But let's continue to desire to be more like Jesus. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you love us. You know us and you love us. And you desire for us to change, to transform, to experience the joy of our salvation. It's not something we have to wait till heaven to enjoy. We can enjoy it now. But Father, we do pray because some of us in our thinking, we are wrong. We have approached our spirituality in wrong ways, in wrong manners. We think about ourselves wrongly. We think about you wrongly. And God, we desire to be corrected, to be set right in our thinking, in our actions. But God, we desire most of all to be changed on the inside. Not trying to fake it, but truly live it. Not that all the problems and issues of life go away, but we face them differently because we face everything with the hope that comes from you. May that be highlighted in our church. May that be highlighted as we live in community. In this church and in this area, God, may others see you in us as you unveil yourself in us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. As Pastor mentioned in his challenge, whatever area of your life you're looking to change, it begins with fully surrendering that to God. And so that's going to be what we, as we sing this morning, as we close our service, I surrender all. Think about what that change looks like in your heart and then surrender it to God. Let's all stand together as we close our service out by singing, I surrender all.
I surrender all to him, I freely give. I will ever love and trust him, in his presence daily live. I surrender all, I surrender.
As you leave this morning, if you do want somebody from the prayer team to pray with you, if you want to have a seat, and as people are leaving, they'll come to see you and pray with you this morning. Have a great week. You are dismissed.
Te adoramos. Te adoramos, Jesús.
Yo agarro una para limpiar esto y otra para limpiar enfrente.
Gracias. ¿Ah? Soy nueva criatura, se llama. Soy nueva criatura, lo declara la Escritura.
Sí.
Buenos días. Te adoramos. No comes las tuyas, yo ya vas a comer eso. ¿Cuaca? En la iglesia allá. Yo ya porfa.
Sí. Sí.
Mire, yo iba a bajar con este peor. Yo me iba a traer todo eso. Que yo me fui para allá y no me acordaba que estaba
pegando. Sí, sí. Okay, okay, sí, sí. Sí, 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 sí. Sí, 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 sí. Sí. Sí.
Te adoramos, Jesús. Probando sonidos, 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 sonido.
Sí, 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 sí.
Podemos ensayar una, la de.
Sí, sí, sí.
No hay lugar más alto. Ok.
Okay, okay. Okay.